Okay, it is one of the most moving portraits of a father-son relationship you're ever likely to read, and it just so happens to involve one of the most beloved movie stars of our time. In A Twist of Lemon, a tribute to my father, Chris Lemon looks back on cherished memories of his father Jack, and in the process gives readers a glimpse into the enormous heart of an enormous talent. Chris Lemon has crafted a genuinely funny and touching work that more than does justice to the man we all love so much on the screen. Of course, Chris is an exceptional multi-talented man in his own right, having starred in over 25 feature films and many of our most beloved television shows. And this fall, he writes, produces, and stars in a new project titled Publicity Stunt. It is a great pleasure to welcome to the show Mr. Chris Lemon. Mr. Lemon, are you with us?
Yeah. Hey, Jamie, Jerry. Great to be with you guys.
Likewise.
Thank you so much for being with us. This is a great honor for us to have the opportunity to speak with you tonight.
Well, it's
thank
my
you.
Pleasure.
First of all, tell me how this book came to be, when the initial idea came about to do one, and what place did you have to get to before you could embark on it?
Well, basically, the book was born out of my just trying to cope with my father's death. I'd lost my mother to cancer 15 years before, so I knew what was coming. And, you know, unfortunately, was a very protracted battle, and lasted over the period of a year. And if anybody who's been through it will tell you, it's in the end, you know, they're still there, but they're not. And there's not much you can do. But what I did, my defense mechanism, was to sit next to him, just hold his hand, and remember all the good times and all the bad. And when he was gone, it took me a while, but there was a real space in my soul that I couldn't figure out how to heal.
Yeah.
So I sat down and started writing those memories on paper, and suddenly realized it was a bit of a catharsis. And so as I wrote some, others would come to me, and I wrote them down. And the next thing I knew, I wasn't just writing the memories. I was writing about my relationship with my father and the father-son relationship in general, and so many other things, you know, learning to find my own path from beneath my father's iconic shadow, so to speak. Mm. And I also, at that point, I realized I think maybe this is something that deserves to be published, hopefully. But I also felt obligated to all those people who adored Pop so much, because, you know, if you loved him on camera, he was just even better off. And these were memories that only I had, and I felt obligated to share them with the people that loved Pop so much. And that's what gave birth to the book.
Well, and you know, we all adored your father too, and but even more than that, this is a book that I think, you know, I'm very close with my parents,
mm-hmm.
and I find real universal truths in this book that move me very deeply. So I thank you in a number of ways for writing this book.
Well, thanks.
But tell me about this existence, being the child of one of the biggest movie stars on the planet,
well,
and trying to find your identity through all of that.
Yeah, it's interesting. One of my favorite chapters in the book is called Jack Lemmon's Son, and
right.
it deals with, you know, the question that I was asked more than any other question throughout my entire adolescence and throughout my life: what's it like to be Jack Lemmon's son? And, you know, I can't really paraphrase a whole chapter in just a couple of sentences, but I think that there's a lot of difficulty in being the child of any famous person, or being the child of, it could be, you know, Harry James the Builder in Petoskey, Oklahoma. You know, oh, you're Jerry's son. No, I'm not. I'm Jamie. You're basically identified as an object and not as a person. I was Jack Lemmon's son growing up. And so it's very difficult to develop your own personality. However, the one thing that I really didn't want to do in this book, and that I think I succeeded in not doing, was to cry into my cup of tea, like every book that's been done of this ilk. There's people out there who are dealing with a lot more serious problems than having to grow up as Jack Lemmon's son. I mean, our sons and daughters are at war, and they're coming home in body bags.
Right.
The last thing I want to do is cry into my cup of tea and say, "Oh, poor me." And I wouldn't have done that anyways. He was just such a great guy. He was magical. It's like he was a human leprechaun, and I got to be his kid. So if there was a little difficult in identity, I dealt with it, and I just, you know, I treasure every memory I ever had with him.
So as a performer, the way that we knew him, how do you describe the Jack Lemmon appeal?
I think that he was very universal. This was a guy who, he was identifiable to a major portion of humanity. And I think a lot of that happened because he was truly a genuine human being, and he truly genuinely cared about other people. And you marry that with his prodigious, to say the least, talent and his incredible instincts, and it really gave birth to what we call the everyman.
Mm-hmm.
And,
that's right.
You know, I guess you to put it the simplest possible way, he reached most of the people most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I think, was due to his not only his talent, but his inherent honesty. And also, he was one of the most emotionally generous people you'll ever want to meet.
Yeah, yeah. But you obviously, you've gone into the acting field, and you had the great pleasure of actually performing with your father. And I'm wondering, from those experiences and also from possibly observing him on set, what you made of his process.
It was effortless. It was incredible, but it was also effortless. I think that most good artists will agree with me, I hope they do, if I say that an enormous amount of the work is really in prep, in writing and creating. I know that's true, but I think it's also true of acting. You have to be prepared, and if you prepare properly, you want to make the actual execution as seamless and as effortless as possible. Maybe another way to put it is you look at a Ferrari. Well, you don't want to see all the brakes and the turbochargers and the this and the that. You want to see that beautiful, sleek body. But you know all that good stuff is underneath. It's the same thing in a performance. All the work, all the effort is done before you ever show up on that set. And then you walk into that set, and it just is, as Pop used to say before, every take over of everything he's ever done, it's magic time.
Yeah, magic time. That's just it. Yeah.
Yeah.
For you, do you have a favorite performance?
It's tough for me to say because he really, as you were mentioning in your introduction, he really was. He covered such a spectrum of performance, from the deepest of drama to the lightest of comedy, and he did it so thoroughly and completely as an artist. It's what do you say? I mean, do we speak about my favorite performance as a comedic actor, as a dramatic actor? You named a bunch of my favorites. Glengarry Glen Ross, even though it was an ensemble piece, I think was one of his strongest performances. By all means, how can you mention Jack Lemmon without saying Some Like It Hot? Probably the greatest comedy of all times. At least that's what AFI thinks. And you also mentioned the film that is nearest and dearest to my heart, which was Missing, where he played Charles Horman, who dealt with the real-life realization that his son had been murdered by a communist regime in South America during the 70s and 80s. And one of the reasons for that is I found out only after he was dead, from my dear wife Gina told me, that he told her, and she thought he told me too. But you know how fathers and sons are. They always tell everybody else, but they don't tell you.
Right.
They tell the kid. that he had actually used me as a role model for the son in Missing. And so that suddenly took on a whole new light for me. And it's still something that's, I get choked up trying to talk about. So. That would definitely be right at the top of the list. I also think it's China Syndrome, you mentioned, I think is a very important piece. And as a matter of fact, it looks like we're getting green-lighted. I'm going to be co-producing and writing a collection of Pops coming out Father's Day 09 with Sony Entertainment, and I'll be hosting it as well. That'll kind of take its lead from the book, from A Twist of Lemon. That'll be coming out Father's Day 09, so we're really excited about that.
Cool.
And, of course, Sony owns China Syndrome, so you better believe that's going to be in there.
Cool.
Wow.
I've really been working to get it to happen, and now it finally is, and it's just, as far as, it looks like it's a green light, at least that's what Sony's saying. And so
that's
very,
beautiful.
Very exciting.
And actually, this book here, this is a perfect Father's Day gift, I find, and anyone that's interested, the icon, you'll see the cover of it on our page that you're on right now. If you click on that icon, it'll take you directly to Amazon where you can purchase it.
Yeah, fabulous. I really want to just take 2 seconds to applaud Algonquin Books originally and Parade Books, who are publishing the paperback internationally now, for having the courage to put out a loving tribute, a Starz Kid story that doesn't have any wire coat hangers in it.
exactly.
It took a lot of guts to do that, and it's just been wonderful to be affiliated with both of those companies, so hats off to them.
It's a beautiful, uplifting, inspirational book.
Thank you. I'm really just, very, very proud of it.
Yeah, I saw an interview with your father. I believe it was Charlie Rose. I watched it just recently.
Yeah.
And he discussed the moments where he found himself in the zone as an actor. And he said they were almost unanimously on the stage. Tell us about the stage actor.
You know, it's wonderful. Peter Gallagher tells a great story in the book, and I've heard him tell it a number of different times. Peter Gallagher, by the way, is one of the funniest guys you'll ever meet on the face of the earth. I don't know if that comes across in his performances, but he's got a terrific sense of humor. But about a wonderful moment, he and Kevin Spacey and Pop and Beth Leslie had done A Long Day's Journey Into Night, Eugene O'Neill's Long Day's Journey Into Night, and I personally think it was the best it's ever been done. And Pop had one of those nights, you know, where he, it's interesting as an actor, you can sometimes do something and then you get off stage and go, how the hell did I do that?
Right.
You know, how do I do it again? And that's the, sort of the wonder of acting. And I think it was one of those nights for Pop, and he came off and I think his words were, Jesus, what the hell was that? And how do I do it again? And, you know, yeah, there it is. I think that he had a number of those. And stage is, of course, it's a whole other medium, even, you know, more so than live television. I mean, you know, all of us actors have done both. I've done my fair share of stage and live television. But there's just nothing like stage, and I think a lot of it has to do with, as an actor, the most important thing to do is listen. Pop, I think, would have been the first one to say that. But defining exactly what listening is a whole other thing. It's not just hearing words. It's not just listening to your other actor. As we would in real life, you know, George Burns' famous words, acting is just like life, and if you can fake that, you got it made. And you know, it's listening to the audience, listening to the room, listening to your environment. It's a whole kind of symbiotic experience that involves all the senses and maybe even some senses that are there that, you know, that can't be labeled, but that really are developed in a fine actor. And that's, I think, why those moments happen for Pop and for most actors, in my opinion, on stage.
Yeah. I have to ask you about a couple of other topics here. And one of them, I mean, when you decided to go into acting yourself, what I find interesting is your father, every step of the way, he allowed you to find your own way.
Yeah, I tried my best not to go into acting, actually, even going to the extent of trying to become a classical pianist and graduating from Cal Arts with a BFA and exactly that. But it was kind of inevitable, you know. It's very interesting. The stuff of the father is passed down to the son. I think it's probably true of mothers and daughters, too, but I'm a son, so that's the only thing I can write from. It really is, and to deny it is irrefutable. I mean, it's you can't, and that's why I think you see so many sons going into their parents' businesses. And
right.
In most other businesses, it's almost expected. You know, Harry and Sons, Johnny and Sons. You know, that the son follow in the father's footsteps. It's only in show business where it's not called following your father's footsteps. It's called nepotism.
That's
and
right.
For some reason, it's, you know, oh, you better be good. You know, here comes Levin's kid. Let's see what he can do. And you know, what can you say? I think that might happen in other businesses too. But I think that it was. Pop was the kind of guy who, you know, he really had a wonderful friendship with me, but he also had an enormous understanding of life, even if he didn't toot his own horn. And he realized, and of course he had an incredible understanding of his own craft, he realized that, you know, acting isn't, you know, you can't just sit down and go, okay, son, here's how you do this. It's a very unique and individual experience, the learning experience. And it has to be done by the person. It can't be, you know, exactly that. Sit your son down and say, here's how you do this. I know my daughter is going into acting, and man, does she have talent up the yin-yang. This gal's got it, and she's going to be huge. And of course, as a father, I did everything I could to dissuade her. None of it worked, and you know, and off she goes. But I'll tell you, what do you say? Well, hon, here's how you act. No.
Right.
That being said, he was the first guy. If I brought a script over, he was the first guy to jump up and get on his feet with me and start running lines and chewing up the furniture.
Oh, that's
so
cool.
Yeah, it really is.
But actually, it's only called nepotism if your last name is Coppola. that's the only time it's called nepotism.
Well, and if you're as talented as Sophia, then they can call you whatever the hell they want.
Yeah.
Right. But you tell the beautiful story about how your father, and you know, the acceptance of my father means the world to me too. So I cried when I read this portion of it, where you did a performance of Love Letters, and it was the closing night.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'll never forget it. And, you know, I always wanted to see, I had a great career. I 30 years straight acting and with, you know, without stop, and made a decent, you know, coin. And boy, that's successful in this business, this crazy business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I've never gotten that part, you know, that my Days of Wine and Roses or my Some Like It Hot. And, you know, that's just the way it was. And I think that, again, it's the whole approval thing. And what I did do, fortunately, was hook up with Stephanie Zimblist, and we did a run of Love Letters, the wonderful play. All of you out there have seen it. And
sure.
it clicked for us. I mean, Steph and I were a little young for the parts, but we pulled it off, I think. I'll put it to you this way. We had full houses every night. And on the final night, Pop came to see us, and it just was one of those performances, you know, it just clicked. And we got a standing at the end, and we stood up to take our bows, and I looked down, and there was Pop, and there were tears rolling down his cheeks.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, I choke up when I remember that night. It was maybe the greatest compliment I've ever been paid as an actor.
Mm-hmm. It is beautiful. And also something else that, I mean, the audiences are certainly taken by it. It was a beautiful relationship was between your father and Walter Matthau.
Well, you know, God bless Walter Matthau. I wake up in the morning, there's little notes on my pillow say, "We're out of cornflakes, F you." Took me 3 hours to figure out that F you meant Felix Unger.
That's my favorite line of that movie.
That is.
The curse of the cat people. What is that?
Yeah.
The curse of the cat people? you know, I mean, it's just, what can you say? Waltz was delicious in humanity. I mean, he in person. If you had to put delicious and describe it as a human being, there was Walter Matthau. And, you know, he adored Pop. I think Walter was the big brother that Pop never had and always wanted. I think if he'd learned to play golf, Pop would have married him. And he was just so much fun. And, you know, I tell a great story about him in the book where, you know, just to give you an example of what he was like. Because they were so wonderful off screen, too. That's one of the reasons I finally decided to take this very personal account, which, quite frankly, I began writing just for myself and for my kids, so they could know their grandfather when they got a little older. But, you know, they were so delicious off-screen, too. I remember when they were shooting Buddy Buddy, Walter had a very bad fall off the scaffolding. And, boy, everybody really thought the worst. And Pop ran over and with, you know, tears pouring out of down his cheeks and folded up his coat and put it under Walter's head and said, Waltz, are you comfortable? And Waltz looked up at him and said, "I make a living."
I love that story.
That story. Oh, I got one more, real quick. One of
yes.
my favorites is Pop was, you know, he didn't make many mistakes, and we can get into that in a bit, too, but he didn't make many mistakes in choosing the material that he did, which can sometimes be just as important as making the choices as an actor. Because, you know, I mean, when you do this stuff, there's, you know, you live with it for the rest of eternity.
Yeah.
But he made it, you know, he did a couple of dogs, and there was one that he did, and he was very concerned and worried about it. And for the screening, he asked Walter to come along with him to be his security mm-hmm. blanket. And sure enough, it just was awful. And at the end of the screening, everybody was very quietly filing out. Quietly at a screening, at the end of a screening, is not a good thing.
Right.
And so finally, after a while, Pop just turns to Walter and goes, so what did you think? Walt turns back and says, "Get out of it."
which one was it?
Yeah, I'm not going to tell you.
Okay, all right. Don't do it.
I wanted to know, because you have a beautiful family of your own.
Yeah.
How has having kids of your own kind of deepened your appreciation, understanding of your father?
Well, you know, I really chose, and it's really kind of half of what the book is about. You know, the book is a dual narrative. It's half memoir and half biography, autobiography. I really chose to take a different path with my kids, and at the risk of my career, you know, to go off to New England to raise them, you know, in a small town, and it was, you know, as difficult as it was to say goodbye to, you know, a pretty successful acting career for a while. In order to do that, it has been the most rewarding thing in my life, because I've been blessed with these three wonderful children who I adore so much. Hopefully they're listening right now. I'll get some big points for that, won't I? but it was interesting a lot, and going back to the whole thing of being raised in Hollywood and the lack of identity and this and that, I just didn't want that to happen to them. But one thing I will say that I, you know, hats off to Pop, was as much of a headlock as the profession puts on you when you get to a level like his, and as difficult as it is to you know, to deal with divorce. And you know, my parents were divorced when I was 3 years old, and so I don't remember what it was like to have my dad sitting at the dinner table. You know, I'll always suffer from what I call the empty chair syndrome, the empty chair at the end of the dinner table.
Right.
But he realized it. And that was when he decided to create these, for lack of a better term, magical adventures that he and I would go on every year. And they were what saved our relationship. That's what pulled us back together. They started with us, and that's what I write about in the memoir section of the book. They started with trips to Alaska to fly fish, catch and release, of course, no barbs on the hooks. Like you said, we're not here to kill him, just to torment him a little. We did that for 20 years up in Alaska, and one of the chapters is about loss of innocence, and it's about how I kind of lost my innocence growing from the age of 11 to the age of 31 at the same time as Alaska was busted open, the last great wilderness, by the pipeline. And nothing against the pipeline, I'm not playing politics here, but I'm just saying it seemed like Alaska and I lost our innocence at the same time. And anyways, to get back to the point, I digress a little. Pop created these wonderful adventures to bring us, to glue us back together. And sure enough, they did. We then went on to Pebble Beach and played a number of Pebble Beach tournaments, the AT&T Pebble Beach Golf Tournament, which was a very bittersweet experience for Pop. I think the only regret he had in life was the fact that he tried to make the cut, which means play well enough on Saturday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday to go on and play on Sunday. He tried for 35 years straight, and he never did.
Yes.
And
you made the cut one year, didn't you, in 94?
I did. Yes, I turned traitor and made the cut. I thought he would never speak to me again. But, you know, and these were these marvelous adventures. You know, it was his way of saying, look, I realize that it has to be, that the business comes first. And that's when he was happiest, was when he was working. But
yeah.
I also adore you, kiddo, and so let's just at least do this. And so we did, and then also there was music. You see, we shared music together. I'm a pianist, he's a pianist, and a wonderful pianist. He really was. Anybody who's heard him play knows that. And so that was our sort of unspoken language. We could sit all night long at the piano and jam together and have great times and
wow.
and discoveries. And that was the catalyst that healed the rift of divorce for us. And he was not just my father. He really, really, truly was my very, very best friend. I can't tell you how much I miss him.
That's fantastic, and it's a fantastic book, and I thank you so much for writing it. Before I let you go, though, you have some exciting things on the horizon. Tell me about your production company and some of the projects you have up.
Well, we got all sorts of fun. Please go visit our website if you're so inclined. It's Stone Manor Productions, STONEMANOR, Productions, plural, or also you can just Google me and it'll come up. We got all sorts of fun stuff. I told you about the box set that I'm doing with Sony, which is just, I really try to keep Pop out there as much as I can because he is so great, and this is really very exciting stuff. They've got a great catalog, so we're really looking forward to that, and maybe you can have me back on this time next year. We'll talk about that.
Oh, we will absolutely.
Sounds good.
That.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, and we got our film publicity stunt. Joel Zwick is directing. Joel Zwick, as you know, is the fellow who directed Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And publicity stunt is very similar in flavor to that. It's been very tough to get made. We were in production, and then unfortunately our funding fell out. You've heard that story 1,000 times with an independent film.
Right.
So we're trying to collect our money right now. It looks like we're getting there. It's always interesting. Filmmakers are, you know, it seems these days filmmakers have become people who go out and raise money, and then every once in a while they get lucky enough to make a film.
That's
right. So we're shooting for production in Connecticut, and you know, so anybody out there with $10 million, give me a call. And
oh, I wish.
We've got a couple of TV projects that we're working on right now that we're very excited about, and some media stuff, and so we're having a great time.
Well, Chris, anytime you want to come back on the show and talk about anything, we
welcome
you,
do.
Sir.
Please.
Well, I'd love to. Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, Jamie. You guys are great.